Luna, Luhudil, Marin, Lucas, Marison, Joseph Mutinda, Steve Rosa, and Julio Torres, Michael Montgomery. Junior deacons, we have Andres Gonzalez, pending transfer of membership, Diego Gonzalez, pending transfer of membership, Daniel Cayalo. Deaconesses, we have Olga Wimberly, Mary Ann Babenko, Rosara Cano, Edith Gonzalez, Rosalinda Gonzalez, Juliana Cayalo, Arola Luna, Madeline Miguel, Sherilyn Miller, Ruth Troncoso, Sharon Mitchell, Marilyn Innocent, Lisette Villegas, and Sophia Villegas. Junior deaconesses, we have Ariana Elizalde, Sarai Elizalde, Itziana Gonzalez, Anna House, Carolina Torres, Camila Torres, and Paulette Troncoso. For treasurer, we have Christopher Charles and Alfonso Corrales. For risk management, we have Jesus Luna. Education secretary, we have Art Camacho. Parliamentarian, we have Diony Rivera. Under adventures, we have Irma Miguel and Karina Garay, pending transfer of membership. AV department, Jason Cushion, Ramundo Gonzalez, Dimitri Holder, Enoch Mitchell, and Brianna Wimberly. Children's ministries, we have Judy Priego, Sophia Villegas. Communications department, we have Donovan Rivera, Metsuri Camacho, and Emma Carrillo. Community service, we have Lauren Cushion, Rosalinda Gonzalez, Louis Asasi, Sherrod Mitchell, and Lisette Villegas. Family ministries, we have Becky House, Norma Galindo. Health ministries, we have Norma Rivera, Marilyn Innocent. Men's ministries, we have Mario Morones and Javier Garcia. Music ministries, we have Norma Galindo and Irish Rivera. Pathfinders, we have Albert Juarez and Lisette Villegas. Personal ministries, we have Pearl Gardner and Dimitri Holder, pending transfer membership. Prayer ministries, we have Awilda Ortiz Ramos, Anna Morones, and Nulali Rosemond. Religious ministries, we have Metzeria Camacho. Sabbath school office, we have Irish Pugao, Ruth Elizalde, Rosalinda Gonzalez, Anna Morones, Eulalie Rosemond, Julie Cayalo, Sandra Moreno, and Brianna Wimberly. Vacation Bible school, we have Chris and Amy Clapp. Visitation ministries are comprised of senior pastor ex officio, associate pastor ex officio, elders ex officio, deacons ex officio, and deaconesses ex officio. Women's ministries, we have Brenda Martinez, Veronica Cerati, and Olga Wimberly. Youth ministries, we have Marisol Gonzalez, pending transfer of membership, Emma Carrillo, Lisette Villegas, and associate pastor ex officio. For the Sabbath school divisions, we have beginners, Alpha Joy Albeza and Amy Rivera, kindergarten, Afia Thompson, and pending transfer of membership, and we do have a vacancy for an assistant. Primary, we have Madeline Miguel and Juanita Camacho, juniors, Albert Juarez and Armida Torres, youth, Emma Carrillo and Art Camacho, young adult, Lauren Cushion and Steve Rosa. Finance committee, we have senior pastor ex officio, associate pastor ex officio, head elder ex officio, treasurer ex officio, and education secretary ex officio. Social committee, we have Lisette Villegas and Abby Flores. Worship oversight committee is senior pastor ex officio, associate pastor ex officio, held elder ex officio, communications director ex officio, and music ministries director ex officio.
Okay, so you have heard the names that were read to us for the following positions. So is there any question or objection to the names presented this morning? Questions or objections? So if there are no questions or objections today, next Sabbath we are going to do the second reading. And if there will be no more or no objection or questions, we are going to vote on these names and will become the official officers of this church for the next 2 years. And let us continue to pray. And if you think that you have been sitting in the pew and you need to help this church, let us know. Because even though that the nominating committee will be done after we approve this report, we are going to pass the names of those who would like to serve for this church through the church board so that you can be a part of this church. So remember, the theme of our recent general conference session that was just over, was done a week ago. It says, I will go. So I hope that we are trying to look at the times that we are living nowadays. There will be, I don't know how long will it be before the Lord is going to come. So we need to become a participant, not just somebody who sits in the pew and then do nothing. The Lord is calling for each and every one of us. We have a part to go. And I hope that we will be ready, and we will be ready to answer the call, I will go. So let's continue with our worship today. Let's call on our chorister to lead us with our opening hymn.
Please stand as we sing our first hymn, hymn number 272. Give me the Bible. You may be seated.
Sabbath, church family. This is a wonderful day to celebrate Father's Day, isn't it? Absolutely. Please turn to your Bibles to Act 17. Acts 17, verses 24 through 28. Acts 17, verse 24 through 28. May God bless this reading. The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth, and does not live in temples built by human hands. And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. From one man, he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth, and he marked out their appointed times in history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far away from any of us. For in him we live and move and have our being. As some of our own poets have said, we are his offspring. For those of you that would like to come up that have special petitions, please come up and kneel if you choose. Dear Lord God, thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, who came down from heaven, became man and God. He was crucified, died, was buried. He was sinless. He rose from the dead. He taught us what we need to do to help live our lives in a godly manner and to follow his commandments. Lord, help us listen to the Holy Spirit as it invokes us to do things that we may not otherwise do as a human. Lord, thank you for the blessings that you've given all of us this day, that we're able to come to church, healthy enough to come to church, and bless you, Lord. Lord, please look over those people that have seemed to have lost their way in regards to their loved ones that are ill, or that have fallen in Christ, those that are having financial challenges, spiritual, marital, and relationship challenges. Help sow the seed of your righteousness in their hearts so that they may find a path that is spelt out for them through the Word of God in the Bible. Lord, thank you for our fathers that are here today that have guided their family to live a Christian life. Lord, thank you for the words that you have given us to help guide us in this path. Lord, help us, fathers, continue to guide our children in the righteous path of your name. We ask this in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Good morning and happy Sabbath. Okay, doesn't want to stay. Okay, we're so happy and so blessed to be here this morning to worship with our church family, to be always here in front of the congregation and to visit with our church friends and family. It is time now to bring the tithes and offerings to the church. And before we do that, let me read Matthew 6, 33. And it reads, "But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you." You might ask, well, what does that have to do with the tithes and offerings? Well, we have an eye problem. You know, we want this, we want that, I want a car, I want a house, I want nice clothes, I want nice shoes, I want. But if we don't put God first, all the wants will keep us from giving God's tithes and offerings. If we seek God first, then He will provide everything. Giving tithes and offerings, once we know God and we commit ourselves to God, will be an easy task. And I know that, and I'm speaking by experience because I had this problem in the past where I couldn't see it, I couldn't make it, I couldn't see how I was going to do it, but turn to God and He will help you through it. Let me finish with another verse. Which is 2 Corinthians nine seven. Every man according as he proposes in his heart, so let him give, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. God will not force you to give anything you don't want to give, but if you accept God, He will instill in your heart to give whatever and even more so than we can afford. Will the deacons please come forward? Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for your wonderful blessings today. We thank you for being with us, for loving us, for taking care of us, for each and everything that you do, even though we don't realize it. Lord, as we take this time today to bring your tithes and offerings to the church, we ask that you bless them, that you allow them to spread the word of your soon coming. We ask all these things in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
I just wanted to make a quick announcement. If you guys are feeling a little bit warm in the sanctuary, it's because it is. I see a couple of you already have made fans from your bulletins. So we have two ACs that are out in the sanctuary. The rest of the church is being cooled, but we need two ACs. We do have insurance money to pay for those, but those are more than 15 years old, so they may need to be replaced. If remember our Project 505, consider giving to Project 505 so we can possibly get funds to replace those if we need to be. Thank you.
Jesus said, "Suffer the little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." It's now time for our little kids to come forward. We will have our children's story hour today. But before that, I'd like to request the kids to pick up your buckets. We are going to collect the offering for our church school. And our storyteller this morning, let me see. Oh, Sister Iris at the back. So Sister Iris is going to give our children's story this morning.
Thank you. Good morning, boys and girls. Let's try that again. I could barely hear you. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
That sounds much better. Okay, boys and girls, do you know what tomorrow is? Father's Day. And what do we do on Father's Day? We celebrate the month of fathers. Well, they don't have the whole month. They get tomorrow, okay? All right, so I brought some things today. On Father's Day, we want to say thank you to our dads, okay? So I brought a few things in my bag, okay? And I want you to tell me what they're used for. What is this?
A tool.
Okay, it's a tool. Do you know what kind of tool?
A wrench.
It's a wrench, right? What do fathers do with wrenches?
Cars.
All right, they fix cars. Good.
They fix things what are like have screws.
Okay, yes, they fix things with screws. So dads like to do a lot of fixing around the house, right? And we are thankful that dads like to fix things around the house, right? All right, what's this?
A baseball.
A tennis racket.
A tennis racket.
That's right. Dads like to play games, right? Do they play games with you? Does your dad play with you?
Yeah.
What kind of games does your dad play with you?
Tennis. Okay, y'all gotta stop answering.
What kind of games does your dad like to play?
Baseball.
Baseball, okay. What about soccer or basketball? Do we like it when dad plays games with us? Yes, it's a lot of fun, and we are thankful that dads like to play games with us. All right, what about this?
Money.
What's this?
Money.
Money, right? Do we need money?
Yes.
Yes, and we are thankful that dads go to work, right, so that he can bring home money and that we can have food and clothes and our house, right? And what is this?
A car.
A car. And what does dad do with a car?
Drive.
Okay, he drives it. He drives us to where?
Places.
To school. Where else?
Daycare.
Where else?
Baby school.
Baby school. Okay, so we are thankful that dads drive us to where we need to go, right? So, you know, there's lots of us who have our dads that are nearby, but there's some of us who have dads that are far away. Maybe they have to work far away, like those dads who are in the military, okay? But we want to say thank you to our dads, not just tomorrow, but every day, okay? And even when our dad is not near us, we have a Heavenly Father who is near us all the time. And we can ask him for help anytime. And we should also thank him for everything that he gives us all the time. All right? Who would like to close Children's Story with prayer? I'm going to let Genesis do it, okay?
Huh? Are you ready? Dear Jesus,
I do. Dear Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for we celebrate Father's Day. And thank you for we get to come here to worship you and praise you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen. Thank you, kids. Go give your dad a hug.
Before we will have our special music that will be rendered for the honor and glory of God by Sister Sofia Villegas, I would like to introduce to you our visitor speaker for today. I do not know a lot of things about him because I just met him at the door this morning. But he told us that he has been in the ministry for more than 15 years. And before he came here to El Paso, he was in Korea. He is one of the chaplains of Fort Bliss, and we are so happy that he can be with us today. He has been in Northeast for quite some time, Northeast Church, and our speaker this morning is none other than Pastor Joel Klimkewicz. But before we will hear his message coming from the Lord, we will be favored by a special number by Sister Sophia.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. Before I sing the song, I kind of just wanted to point some stuff why I picked it out. The first time I heard this song, it really resonated with me, and I feel like it really touched my heart. I feel like sometimes we have constant trials and tribulations, yet we have one person that we can really confide to, and that is our faithful God. I guess they're having some technical difficulties.
See the light of day, but I am persuaded beyond all hope you won't let go of me. I stake my claim on every word you say, you will not be late. I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you with my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. You're a faithful God. The darkest of weather, though I can't see, I still believe you're good. So I'm moving forward through crashing waves. I know I'm safe with you. You hold my life, you hear my cry. With every breath inside, I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you with my life. I know my story, it isn't over. Even against all odds, you are a faithful God. That's who you are. You are a faithful God. I am convinced that your promises will hold together, and I will dwell in the hope of your love forever. I am convinced that your promises will hold together, and I will dwell in your love. And I will sing through fire and thunder, 'cause you are on my side. I trust you with my life. I know my story, it isn't over, even against all odds. You are a faithful God. That's who you are. Oh, you are a faithful God. Oh God.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Let's see if our technology is going to work for us. You want to just go to this one? There we go. Let's see if this will work. Okay, yeah, we're good. Nice. Well, I'm glad to be. Can I move this away? Is this okay? Okay, because I have a lapel mic here, right? Okay. Well, folks, it's hot, right? Let's turn up the heat a little bit. You ready for it? Okay, I'm warning you. God does not live in this church. Is that hot enough for you? God does not live in this church. I mean, this is my first time here, and I can say with confidence that God does not live in this church. How do you feel about that? Are you ready to stone me? Today's a special day, isn't it, for not just for Father's Day Sabbath, but a bigger holiday in Texas. Bigger than Father's Day is Juneteenth, right? How many of you know Juneteenth? Those of you who are in the military, you know Juneteenth, right? Because we have a four-day weekend. I heard it. Do it again. Yeah, I mean, if you work for the federal government, things are going well for you today, right? Because you got Monday off, so you're thinking about all the parties you're going to have after church. No? You're going to go into a potluck coma? All right. So Acts chapter 17, I need you to turn in your scripture to Acts chapter 17. We're going to stick in verse 24 through 28, Acts chapter 17. The book of Acts is like, I think book of Acts is my favorite book in the Bible because it's an active book. It's a book about things happening. It's the formation of the early church. It is a special supernatural connection that God has with his church to establish it here on the earth. And then we still fit in that. Isn't that amazing? That 2,000 years later, we still fit into the great work of the book of Acts. So Acts chapter 17, it's a powerful message that Paul gives. And before we get there, just want to talk a little bit about proclamation and what that means. So Juneteenth is a day of proclamation. How many know the history of Juneteenth, what that actually means? All right, so Juneteenth, there was a pronouncement made almost 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, right? The Emancipation Proclamation goes out from D.C. You have Lincoln who wants to free the slaves, but we're in the middle of a war as a nation. And the southern states are not going to accept the message of emancipation. 2 years later, the slowness of communication moving to all the way to Texas, finally the message gets here that the slaves are free. Right? You think they didn't know about that before? You think Texans didn't know that slaves were free? Of course. How long would our nation contend with the ignorance of its people to reject the freedom of all those who are African in descent? So the proclamation goes out June 19th, 1865. The people of Texas are informed that in accordance with a proclamation from the executive of the United States, all slaves are free. Now, folks, I don't know about you, but that would be a good enough message in and of itself. I mean, it's pretty authoritative. All slaves are free. It's a great proclamation. It's the gospel, isn't it? It's the elements of the gospel that we all support, that God has come to bring freedom to the captives. Jesus has come to free us from the bondage of our sin. So when our nation began with the great sin of slavery, almost abolished, by the way, until Eli Whitney created that cotton gin, and then slavery robustly came back because of the need for laborers. The war was fueled by religion in the South because of those folks who would say that the Bible justifies slavery. So it would be enough of a message to share the proclamation of the gospel that the slaves are free. That in and of itself would be a great proclamation. But of course, being the men that we are in a society of creating hierarchy, there's more that follows in this statement given in June 19th, 1865. The slowness of communication 2 years after the Emancipation Proclamation, it is pronounced in Galveston that the slaves are free. This involves an absolute equality of personal rights and property between former master and slaves, and the connection hereto existing between them becomes that between employers and the hired laborer. In other words, that there's equality. The freed men are advised to remain quiet. All right, you're free, but shut up. Don't create too much noise. Don't go out and share how great your liberty is. Don't assemble, is the next statement that's given. Don't assemble. Don't gather. Don't get together to have organization. The freedmen are advised to remain quietly at their present homes and work for wages. Get a job and get a haircut. They are informed that they will not be allowed to collect at military posts and that they will not be supported in idleness either there or elsewhere. By the way, Texas, of course, became a great supporter of the military after the Civil War, right? I mean, you have a lot of our military bases in Texas. Fort Bliss is a historic base, isn't it? Could you imagine going outside Fort Bliss and saying, "Hey, Africans, don't you dare assemble here." How insulting to your freedom. How insulting to your freedom to say, "You're free, it's proclaimed, but don't tell anybody about it. Stay quiet." How insulting to your liberty to say, "Don't assemble and gather and let the power of your unity share in the liberty that you have been given." Folks, this is the story of the early church. The proclamation of June 19th, 1865 is intrinsically linked to the story and the presentation of the gospel from its inception. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 12, "Woe to you, the inhabitants of the earth, because the devil has gone down to you. But those who overcome, those who are faithful in the testimony of Jesus, live such a life that they're not afraid of losing their own lives, even in the proclamation of the gospel." Revelation chapter 12. Fortunately for us, we celebrate June 19th today because there were people who would not stay quiet in their liberty. They would not quiet the sounds of their heart that cried out, "We're free!" Because freedom is powerful. So June 19th isn't just a day to have a four-day holiday. It is the presentation of the gospel for folks who were in bondage and became free, and we should celebrate it and link it intrinsically to the message of Acts in the early church when God said, "Let my church be built and let the proclamation of the gospel go forward." Acts chapter 2 starts out with they were all in one place. They're gathered together. They're meeting together. They're assembled, and there's power in assembly. And folks, I mean, in case you haven't really read the book of Acts chapter 2, we talk about the gift of tongues and we say, oh, this supernatural manifestation where they were speaking in tongues. Well, when I read it, it actually says they were hearing language in their own language. Sounds like the gift of hearing to me rather than the gift of speaking. I mean, you've heard the saying before, you got two ears and one mouth. The gospel has a lot to do with hearing too, doesn't it? That when it's proclaimed, there's power in its proclamation. And when it's proclaimed in public, it's even more powerful because somehow we are linked to the hearts of other people that are around us and we become convicted together. The Church of Acts is moving. It's moving forward. It's doing things. It's accomplishing things. And so we get to Acts chapter 17 and we see what it is doing in the life of Paul as he is on his way to travel to Corinth and makes a quick stop in Athens. When Paul makes a stop in Athens, it's a unique situation because someone took my paper, didn't they? That's okay, I don't need it. So it's a powerful experience because he's planting churches and he's moving and he's itinerant in some ways, but he stays a little bit, get churches going, and then he moves on. But he stops in Athens waiting for Timothy, right? Waiting for Timothy and Silas, and he wants to wait for them because imagine having to walk to Athens by yourself. That's about a day journey. If you were to drive, it's about a day and a half journey. An hour and a half journey. But as you're walking up the coast, I can imagine Paul wanting to just have conversations about the formation of his church in Corinth and connect with his pastor friends as they develop something significant for the cause of Christ. But he stops in Athens to wait for them. And as he's in Athens, he's not going to be idle. According to the book of Acts chapter 17, it starts out that he's moving from Thessalonica, then he's going to Berea, and then now he stops in Athens on his journey. And he has a unique encounter in Athens. Let's read verse 16. Now while Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him, and he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews. There are two philosophies here, the Epicureans and the Stoics, and they also conversed with him and said, "What does the babbler wish to say?" So you can imagine, Paul is already being met with some kind of confrontation. What is this babbler trying to say? As he's proclaiming the gospel, you know, they're criticizing him. What is this babbler trying to say? Because the two philosophies that he's dealing with are like your first service and your second service. Your 8:30 group and your 11 group. I'm just kidding. They're both good groups. But one is the Stoic group. And they are, man, they, listen, these guys will beat their bodies into subjection. They eat, they don't have the philosophy like the Epicureans that you eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow you die. For them, potluck starts on time. And if you show up late, you're not getting anything. I had this church once. I'm afraid to tell this story. Somebody's watching. So I had this church, and there was this lady there who we affectionately called the potluck Nazi. And the potluck Nazi felt it her duty to make sure that everyone had a new plate when they went up into the line and that they could not go to the line without either washing their hands or using hand sanitizer. And she would run up from her seat and she'd go to the front of the line and she would literally slap people's hands for not hand sanitizing or not getting a new plate. So the Stoics are like the potluck Nazis. The Stoics are like those folks who everything has to be in order and my life has to be subjugated and subjected, and they would really hate a person like me who's free and spontaneous and never plans anything, including this sermon. Just kidding. But then there are the Epicureans. And the Epicureans, they had this philosophy of eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die. Everything goes, man. Let's just enjoy it. Let's live it up. Free love and money and whatever it is. Just give it all to me. So these are philosophies that are diametrically opposed, and they're in the same place. Sounds like our church, right? People who are on both sides of the spectrum. Now, we need everyone. In order to have the group that's in the center, we need everyone. We need both ditches. And so Paul is dealing with these people, and some of them are mocking him, and he just doesn't, he doesn't understand that what he's about to walk into is a primed pump for chaos. He thought he was just stopping in Athens waiting for Timothy, Silas to go on to their little missionary journey to the port city of Corinth, where the church had already been going, but it needed a little bit of help. If you've read 1 Corinthians, you've read 2 Corinthians, you see that the problem that was going on in Corinth was that people were using spiritual gifts to abuse other people and to make themselves seem like they were greater in the proclamation of the gospel because of their spiritual gifts. And Paul says to them very shameful things like, I heard you speak in tongues, but I'll tell you what, I can say way more in tongues than you can. I'm way better at it than you can. But I'd rather you said five intelligent words than 5,000 that no one could understand. So he's pretty hard on them. Paul knows his audience. And Paul knows his audience when he goes into the city of Athens. He knows that they're academics. He knows that they sit around and they argue about things. He knows that even the Jews in the synagogue do not believe in the resurrection. Of course. So Paul, he wants to have a conversation about things that people don't understand. So in verse 19, it says that he was taken to the Areopagus, which was a meeting place. We know it as Mars Hill. Mars Hill was a place that was right below the Acropolis, just one tier down, where you had the temple of Athena and Agora, and you had all these temples all around, the temple of Zeus, and just, you know, a whole city full of temples. You can still go there today, and those temples still exist, many of them in full form. And so Paul is brought to this Areopagus, to Mars Hill. In verse 20 it says, "For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." So they're curious. And why are they curious? Well, they're curious because according to the book of Acts, they sit around and study all day and put nothing into practice but learn and learn and learn and are intrigued by new teachings. The term we use for them in our culture is academics, right? They're academics living in their ivory tower, but nothing ever impacts the ground. There's no praxis. There's no action. And remember, Acts is a book of action. That's why it's called the book of Acts. And in a book of action, Paul is trying to move people to action because he's in ministry. And so this story, I think, is really enlightening about how to move people into action. And here it goes on. That in verse 22, so Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens." Can you imagine if we went to the International Bridge and we all get there together and we're like, "Men of Juarez," right? And then they correct us because we said it wrong. It's like, listen up. Something important is about to be said. You take your blowhorn and you go downtown to El Paso with a blowhorn. In today's culture, probably very few people will listen to you. We're just not in that same cultural context that Paul was in, where he could stand on Areopagus on Mars Hill and he can make a pronouncement and engage in a dialogue and he'd get an audience. But in those days he could, and he did. So he says, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious." This is an interesting statement for people who are actually not really religious. Imagine that I say to someone who's an atheist, "I see that you're very religious." Remember, these are academics in Athens that are there to talk about philosophies. They want to talk about, you know, the teachings of Aristotle and Socrates and you know, they want to discuss Plato. So they have some sense of connection to the spiritual realm in that they don't believe in resurrection, but they do believe that this is not reality, that the reality is the spiritual world. But they are not religious. They do not believe that there are gods in the temples. That is nothing more than a tourist attraction that we take students to and talk about the philosophers who once gathered here, which is not much different from Greece today. And so Paul says this statement to them, "I see you are very religious." Knowing his audience, he's looking for some feedback. "For as I passed along to observe the objects of worship, I found also an altar with an inscription to the unknown God. What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man. Nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything." I'm going to stop there for a second, because this proclamation is pretty significant. See if this will work for me. So first in Acts chapter 17, verse 24, he says, "The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands." Now, if you had a temple and you believed that you needed to gather there to meet with your God, would you be insulted by that? You'd be insulted, right? Like when I started this sermon, I said to you, God does not live here. Were you insulted by that? Some of you were insulted by that. Because some of you heard Moses, the story of Moses and the tabernacle, and then others, you know, believe that Solomon, when he dedicated his temple, that it was something great. And yet others connect more with what Jesus says is, tear down this temple in 3 days and rebuild it again, and I'll show you the power of God, right? Some people connect differently with God and in different places. And Moses was told, build them a tabernacle that I might dwell among them, right? And then on top of that, the book of Revelation says, now the dwelling place of God has become the place where men are too, and we are together. The tabernacle of God has become the dwelling place of men. So there's some kind of connection to the physical place and to God. There's something there, but what is it? When Paul says to these people, the God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands, he's not just insulting them, he's aligning himself with his audience because they already believe that. They believe in the spiritual realm. Nothing here is literal. Nothing here physical is literal. Everything is just a projection in a Platonic sphere and circle of things that are really from a bigger place, a bigger realm of philosophical thought. So Paul is recognizing his audience and he's aligning himself with them when he says, I see that God does not live in these temples. And they're like, yeah, right. That's why we have the temple for the unknown God, because we really don't know who God is. And so when Paul says, let me proclaim him to you, he comes alongside of them and he said, everything that was not made by human hands. And this is right in line with Greek thinking. And so in Acts 7, verse 48, there's a very similar statement. However, the Most High does not live in houses made by human hands. And this statement was given by who? Stephen. It's an important statement. In Acts chapter 8, who's given approval to Stephen's killing? Interesting message, huh, Paul? I mean, taken right from the mouth of the man that you murdered, right? Uh-oh, what did I do? Can you get me going again? I'm all jacked up. Sorry. We'll get it together. So the significance here is in these statements that Paul makes and where they come from. So let's turn to Acts chapter 7. Acts chapter 7. If you have your Bible, if you don't have your Bible, I'm sure there's a pew Bible. But Acts chapter 7, there's something about physically feeling the Bible in your hand, right? Acts chapter 7, when Stephen gives his speech, I'm going to save you from the entire speech because we'd be here all day and you'd miss your potluck and the potluck Nazi would come after me. But look at what happens here. Stephen takes them through all the patriarchs and the significance of the patriarchs and why they didn't have a home and why they never considered the dwelling place of God a physical place. Abraham left his home and goes to Ur and has no physical connection with God in a building. Moses doesn't even get a literal building. He's got a burning bush. But God is still there with him. And yet Moses was told to make a temple. And the actual temple doesn't even come about until Solomon. And when Solomon builds a temple, according to 1 Kings, Solomon doesn't even believe God will live in his temple. So he says to God, I'd like you to live here, but since you won't, and the earth is your footstool, could you please just look at us once in a while we're here? Right? Like, that would be enough. That would be enough. If you just, wherever you are, God, the earth is your footstool, heaven is your throne. But if you could just, like, turn your eyes upon us, we'd feel that, and that would be enough for us. Because God does not live in temples made by human hands. And as Stephen goes to his death, he goes to his death proclaiming that the temple that God lives in is the human heart. The place where God can really affect change. The place where it matters. The place where when we gather together, ecclesia, the church, when we gather together, our hearts become one and God moves. It is the entire thesis of the book of Acts. That when we gather together and become one, God moves and shapes and builds his church into something great. The proclamation, men of Athens, God lives in you. It's freedom. It's freedom for the captives, freedom for the slaves. It is the emancipation message that no longer do you have to be subjugated to the institutional model of church. In fact, the entire book of Hebrews was written after this concept. Please, oh please, converted Jews, do not go back to the temple. There's nothing there for you. Jesus has a better sanctuary. Jesus has a better message. Jesus has better blood. Jesus has an indestructible life. What do you need a priest in a temple for? Because God lives in the heart. But the problem is this, folks, and this problem is pervasive, and it's pervasive in our church, in our culture, in our traditions, in the ways in which we can't break free, in the ways in which you won't share the gospel because you think the pastor has to do it. The issue is this, is that the institutional model of the church has institutionalized us such that we will never break free from it because we won't let God live in the confines of our heart. It's too dangerous to let God live in your heart. It's way too risky to let God unite you with your brother and with your sister. And here's why it's risky. It doesn't feel good to be convicted. How many of you have felt like a good Christian recently? I like Hebrews chapter 10 that says, he who comes will come and will not delay. My righteous one will live by faith. But if he shrinks back, I'll be displeased with him. But we are not those who shrink back. We are those who persevere. And we live righteously by faith, not by feeling. So despite the fact that I feel inadequate, I mean, that is the conviction of the Holy Spirit to help me to feel that I need to come closer to God. And that happens more and more and more when we send the message in an audience in which people connect with their hearts and with their minds and with each other. That becomes more of a convicting, powerful experience, and we feel like we need to change, and it's painful to change. It's a lot easier to enjoy the sights and the sounds and the traditions of the building. I mean, imagine the temple. It stunk, right? All those sacrifices and blood all over the place. But there was incense burning. And you could go and you could get into the pew and you could experience the outer court if you were not part of the elite, if you were a Greek. And you could just have that incense rush over you, all that smell all over there, the smell of bread in the, you know, in the outer court, the people selling things, all of the experiences of the culture and the tradition. And see a tangible priest offer a sacrifice in which you participated in, And there's something about the feeling of those traditions that make us more secure and more assured than the God who just lives in our heart. The God that lives in our heart is dangerous. He's risky. He moves us to action. The God that helps us to show up to the church and get into the pew wants us to conform so that we are ineffective. Wants to institutionalize us so that we're not a threat. And so when Jesus comes and he says, you know, that the message of the gospel will storm the gates of hell, right? When Jesus comes and he frees us from the institutional model of the church, when Jesus comes and creates people like Stephen who would be willing to be stoned for saying that God doesn't live in your temple, he lives in the human heart, things happen. The world gets shaken. Like when freed slaves assemble when they were told not to assemble. Like when freed slaves proclaim the power of their freedom by trying to buy land, and they're shut down and they keep trying. In Texas, even doing things like trying to become like cattle ranchers and being murdered and hung and lynched for just trying to do what everyone else does. There's risk in following your conviction. There's risk. For Stephen, it caused his death. But look what the death of Stephen did to Paul. Stephen dies preaching the message, God does not live in houses made by human hands. He lives in the confines of your heart. And Saul approved his killing. But yet, Paul is the one who said, for in him we live and move and have our being, quoting the Greek philosopher Epimenides. And then in the next part of the verse, as some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. In other words, God lives in us, which a Stoic philosopher said, Erastus. And then in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 16, where he's on his way to Corinth to share the message of the power of the gospel, he says, do you not know that you are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in you? And you get the sense that Paul's message of a God who lives in the walls of the heart and not in the walls of a temple was brought to him in his conviction and his confrontation with the man he killed. Because anyone who's willing to go to death for what they believe is bringing some serious conviction our way. I told you I was going to turn the heat up, right? It's hot. That is the last slide, I promise you. But in Acts chapter 17, as we bring this to a close very soon, in Acts chapter 17, there is a little bit of a twist to Paul's message. We can clearly see that he was convicted by Stephen. We can clearly see that this is his testimony, that this is his proclamation of the gospel based on his conviction, that Stephen got to him and that he was confronted with it. And even that road, right, to that road experience with Jesus, he says, Jesus confronts him and says, why are you persecuting me? Clearly, the message of Stephen is where his conviction to change his course came from, where he goes from Saul to Paul. That's clear in his message to the Athenians. But look at this in verse 25, okay, verse 26. And he made from one man every nation and every kind to live on the face of the earth, having determined a lot of periods and the boundaries of the dwelling place. By the way, that came from Stephen too, who is bringing up that the patriarchs could only go where God wanted them to go. That message also came from Stephen. But then when it goes on, it says that they should seek God and perhaps feel that their way, feel their way toward him. Like, just feel your way a little bit. Sounds like a Solomon message. Just look at us. Feel your way. Maybe accidentally run into God because he is to be found. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us. He's always close to us. He lives in the confines of our heart. In him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone or image formed in the art and imagination of a man. In other words, we create our own gods when we worship the works of our own hands. Which is a great message. I mean, I don't think it's a major message. It's a great message here. Then the times of arrogance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent because he has fixed a day, on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man he has appointed. And this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead. This is where the message turns. I mean, if you want to incite violence to a Jew, because we have Jews here, right? You start bringing up the resurrection. The resurrection is a foreign thought. The resurrection is an issue. And the issue with the resurrection is one for the Greek who believes everything is in the spirit world. Everything is a projection of the spirit world. Therefore, we got a big problem in messaging. The big problem in messaging, which you can see in many other churches, is that what do you do with disembodied spirits? It seems kind of absurd. And anyone who is a thinking, logical person is going to come to the conclusion that we have to do one of the two things. We need to get rid of the resurrection, or we need to get rid of the disembodied spirits. And if you're a Greek philosopher, probably not going to get rid of the disembodied spirits. Right? Everything is about the spirit world. So many of them right then and there turn and reject that message. So remember this in context as you're sharing the message of your testimony, as you're sharing something powerful that God has done. It's important to know your audience. Really important to know your audience. This is a lesson that I think Paul learned. Probably if Paul were to resurrect today, he'd say, man, if I had just foregone that little resurrection discussion and kept that for a private conversation with the Jews. He might have got more Greeks. And so the context here that we need to pay attention to is that when we share our personal testimonies, we really have to know our audience. And Paul generally knew his audience, and he starts out really good knowing his audience. But when the turn for the resurrection happens in front of the Greeks, who are Platonic thinkers, there's a little bit of a disconnect. Like this, when I was a pastor, I had this church member, and I told the first group earlier this message. When I was a pastor, there was this guy who saw a bunch of Baptists putting up a billboard that said, Jesus is Lord of the Sabbath. And he said, okay, I got to stop. So he stops and he confronts them. And he says, you know you all worship on the wrong day, right? Do you think he made a friend? I mean, of course they associate Sabbath with Sunday. I mean, even though their pastor, who is educated, probably knows that Sabbath is the seventh day. I mean, but the average person in the pew associates Sabbath with Sunday, right? So if you're putting up a statement, Jesus is Lord of the Sabbath, there's a better way. There's a Pauline way to confront this by sharing your testimony. You could say, wow, you guys believe in the Jesus is Lord of the Sabbath too? Isn't that amazing? Isn't Sabbath amazing? Jesus loved the Sabbath so much, and it's become so important to me. Like, Jesus loved the Sabbath so much that he decided to die on Friday, rest on Saturday, and resurrect on the first day of the week. And he could just walked away, leaving them wondering, like, what is this babbler talking about? Like the message of Paul, right? What is this babbler talking about? And then they could go and kind of search their heart themselves, and you made a friend, and plus you helped to reveal some things. And I shared with the other group that I like the message that David Asherick says when he says, you know, you cannot just share your entire table of truth at one sitting. We have to tactfully approach these things. So perhaps Paul went a little too far. I don't know. I mean, I'm not Paul. I wasn't there. But just reading in and a little poetic license in the story, perhaps Paul went a little too far when he starts sharing with philosophically minded Greeks about the resurrection and not really having time to flesh that out or explain it. I don't know. But he said it for this reason. He said it because the Jews have no excuse but to accept the resurrection, which he says the time of ignorance is being like done away with. The time of judgment, these are your teachings. The resurrection is a very biblical concept from the beginning. I mean, hello, Ezekiel, dry bones coming to life, right? The resurrection is not a New Testament concept. God breathing into man and making him a living being is not a new concept. It is the way in which he created all life. And so, I don't know, it's a great message, but maybe the wrong audience, hard to tell. But it is a lesson to us about how to share things in time and in season. And so when Paul closes this, there are people that follow him greatly. There is people who still, you know, follow him. And so he moves on and he goes to Corinth. And when he's in Corinth, I think the evidence of the church in Corinth is that there is a continuation of this message that God lives in the walls of the human heart. When he develops the whole concept of the ecclesia, the church being the temple, and then the human heart also being the temple, that both are the temple of God, that us, when we assemble, God is with us. Whether we're in a building or we're not in a building, God is with us and powerful things happen. But yet when we are alone as individuals, God is in us too. He's in us as individuals and powerful things happen. And so the power of the gospel is found in the testimony of Paul, who discovered it by killing a man. Please don't go out and kill a man when you tell your testimony. Please don't have a testimony when you leave this church that you had to murder someone to gain the wisdom and the knowledge of the gospel. Please learn from the mistakes of Paul, right? Learn from Solomon, who says, God, if you just look at us, we'll do powerful things. Learn from the book of Acts that says, God, if we're assembled together, we'll do powerful things. You don't have to have a dramatic testimony to share a testimony. You just have to have a connection with the church, with us, and you have to have a connection to the God who lives in your heart. And the way to do that, it seems very simple, but assembling together, right? Connecting to each other, to the witnesses that we bring to each other, and encouraging one another. Right? That's what the scripture says. Encourage each other while we see the day approaching that we need to stay together. It is that great vision that we have in our church, right? Of Christ in the front and Christ in behind, and we're on the narrow path. Some of you got that. I won't say your name. So when you leave here, share your testimony. Find your own Areopagus. Find your own Mars Hill. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we leave here today, Lord, we are convicted to share what you are doing in our heart. We pray, Lord, that you will introduce people to us, the right people, that we can share the right truth, the right message, the right conviction that you have brought to us. Live in our hearts, Lord. We know that you live in the walls of our hearts. You do not live in temples made by man. You don't live in this building as a church. You live in us as a church. Thank you for that promise. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we sing our closing hymn, hymn number 462, Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine.
Blessed Assurance, Jesus is Mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation. My song, praising my descending, bring from above echoes of mercy, whispers of love.
So Lord, as we close and our hearts are one together, we pray that you convict us. Help us to share your word and the gift of what the cross brought us, Lord, the assurance that our hearts are washed clean, that our sins are forgiven. And Lord, that you have given us the promise of a new heaven and a new earth, a place where there will be no more tears and no more suffering. We pray, Lord, that you can help us to lead others there as well. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please be seated, and our deacons will show you out. And to celebrate our fathers for tomorrow's Father's Day, for all fathers, when you go out, in as much that you are very sweet, you need to see Sister Lauren, and she has prepared something sweet for you. So once again, have a sweet Father's Day, and may we have a wonderful Sabbath.